Well, thank you very much, and I'm certainly pleased to be here to talk about hotter, wetter, wilder, preparing for climate change. Or in other words, when things go wrong along the lines of that which you see depicted on the slide, and perhaps in the lower left-hand corner, too much water in the wrong place causing flooding and an obvious degree of discomfort for this individual. Or we have fires occurring across the country with increasing frequency and magnitude, having a negative impact on homes and businesses and communities in forested regions of Canada. Or we have temperature that's going to be lethally hot going forward. It is going to get a lot hotter in Canada going forward, for sure. Or we have conditions on the lower right-hand side where we have sea level rise combined with storm surge, combined with king tides, causing negative impacts along coastlines. Are we prepared as a country for these events when they happen and the degree to which they will increasingly happen going forward? And by the way, this is not a long list. I haven't said anything about snow load or ice storms or wind storms or permafrost loss. There's lots of things that are going wrong and will continue to go wrong, driven by climate change. And the question is, are we prepared as a country? So that's what I want to address. Now, to drill down just a little bit more, I'll focus on four lines of discussion. First, I'm going to drive home the point that climate change is real. And number two, that it is irreversible. Climate change is here to stay. We're not going backwards on climate change. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be doing everything we can to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions and lower the rate of climate change, but we're not going backwards on climate change. Number two, I will document what do the costs of climate change look like relative to the pictures you saw in the previous slide, the floods, the fires, and so forth. What do those costs, how do they actually manifest themselves, or how are they manifesting themselves going forward? And effectively, I will present the catastrophic loss insurable claims data in the country that really depicts what these costs look like. And then I can tell you right now, for the first two points, quite frankly, this is not uplifting. It's depressing. But things get a little bit better, because I'm going to turn to, in the third point, to consider the degree to which Canada is preparing to address extreme weather. We haven't just been sitting on our hands in this country. I would say over the last 5 or 6 years, we've developed a lot of substantive, meaningful, practical programs to deploy to lower the damages that occur when these extreme weather events occur. And then finally, I'll end with, has Canada got it right on climate change? And the answer is a little bit yes and a little bit no. So that's where we're heading. So starting with the first point first, climate change is real and irreversible. The reality is, over the period of about the last 100 years, temperature on the planet has increased by about 1.1 degrees Celsius. We're 1.1 degrees Celsius warmer today on average around the planet than was the case about 100 years ago. And at first, when you hear that, it doesn't really sound like a big deal, 1 degree Celsius warmer. Matter of fact, I was explaining this to my next door neighbor a little while ago, and I said to her, you know, we're 1 degree Celsius warmer on the planet today than we were 100 years ago. And she said, well, that sounds nice. Not realizing that the difference in the temperature in the planet today versus an ice age is about 5 or 6 degrees Celsius. So being up 1 degree Celsius warmer over a very short period of 100 years is a really big deal when you consider the fact that the difference between the temperature we have today and glaciation and a glacial period is 5 or 6 degrees Celsius. And by the way, this being warmer 1.1 degrees Celsius over the last 100 years, this is not just my cavalier opinion. This is the opinion expressed by, for example, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is an assemblage of several hundred climate scientists who have published a series of reports that state exactly that point. And also more recently, as presented by Canada in Canada's Changing Climate Report 2019, which is authored by a large number of climate scientists working for Environment Canada, they also underscore this point. And indeed, they say in their report, and I've put the material in presentation here in italics because I'm quoting directly from the report, they say the Earth has warmed during the industrial era, which is about the last 120 years. Only when human influences on climate are accounted for, and that is the burning of fossil fuels, loading carbon into the atmosphere, which traps energy that would escape into space, it holds it in our atmosphere, causes warming, and therefore we realize the damages. It is only when human influences on climate are accounted for can these observed changes in climate be explained. And they end with, this warming is effectively irreversible. So climate change is here to stay. Extreme weather will manifest itself going forward. We have to prepare for that. Now, what do the costs look like associated with climate change? And what you're looking at here, this is the catastrophic loss insurable claims data for Canada over the period in the lower left-hand corner from 1983 up to and including 2019. So this is the amount of money that insurance companies pay out on the left-hand axis in billions of dollars. This is the amount of money that insurance companies pay out when major storms hit. Floods, fires, hailstorms, windstorms, that sort of thing. There is a group called CatIQ that adds up these numbers on an annual basis and presents them as you see in the histograms here or with the blue bars. And what you can see is from about 1983 up to 2008, the catastrophic loss claims data in Canada were somewhere in the zone of about $250 to $450 million per year. That's how much money the insurance companies could count on paying out. There was the odd exception here and there, like the Eastern ice storm in 1998 that was pretty expensive. But otherwise, we were in the zone of about $250 to $450 million a year. But what's happened from about 2009 forward to the present is that for 11 out of the 12 years, because I just saw the data for 2020, the catastrophic loss claims data has gone over $1 billion per year every year for 11 out of the last 12 years for an average cost of about $1.8 billion per year. And by the way, all this data is corrected for inflation and for per capita wealth accumulation. In other words, it's a comparison of apples to apples. So what's going on here? The number one culprit that's driving the upward bend in this curve is too much water in the wrong place, flooding. Flooding is the number one cost in Canada associated with climate change. It is the elephant in the room, and more specifically, residential basement flooding, flooding basements. The second most expensive impact to the country is fire affecting homes, communities, businesses, and forested regions. Now, the question is, how are we preparing for this? What can we do? What can we implement? What can we develop as a country to bend this curve down, to keep these costs down? And this is where Canada has done a lot of good work over the period of, I would say, about the last 5 or 6 years. The Standards Council of Canada, working with the National Research Council, working with the Canadian Standards Association, certainly Intact Centre right in the middle of this, combined with a multitude of expert organizations, we have developed very, very good guidance for Canada in reference to how we can lower flood risks at the level of the house, at the level of the individual house. What can we do around the outside of the property and in the basement itself to lower the probability that flood water will enter into a basement? We've developed guidelines to mitigate flood risks for new residential community design. We know how to build new communities in Canada with fundamental features and characteristics in place that make it such that when the big storms hit, those communities won't flood out. We've developed flood risk mitigation for existing communities. We know how to use berms and diversion channels and holding ponds and cisterns to direct water to safe locations and keep it out of harm's way. And we've developed very good guidance on how to protect large office towers and apartment buildings from not having a flooded basement. And right now we're developing a coastline resiliency standard for Canada to make it such that the problems associated with sea level rise and storm surges aren't problematic going forward. So we've done a lot of very good work in the country of how to prepare for storms, and now we need to deploy that material. And I'm going to give you just a quick illustration of what we can do at the level of the house to lower the probability that when a big storm's hit, your home or a home that you might rent will end up with a flooded basement. We've developed something called the Home Flood Protection Program with all of the organizations I mentioned previously involved in this. And effectively, it's a 15-step program of actions that can be taken around a house that, when deployed, lower the probability that water will end up in a basement. So for example, in the lower left-hand corner, you see a sewer grate with leaves on it. And particularly at this time of the year, the fall in Canada, we want to make sure that we remove leaves from sewer grates such that if a big storm occurred that day, the water can drain into the sewer grate and safely flow to a safe location, as opposed to the storm grate being covered over with leaves, a big storm of maybe 50 or 80 millimeters hits over a period of a few hours of rain coming down over a few hours, builds up on the street and the water flows into the basement. And indeed, in a small town in southern Ontario about 3 years ago, Guelph, Ontario, they had a storm occur with about 60 millimeters of rain over a short period of time. The sewer grates were covered up, and it ended up costing about $25 to $30 million in damage of flooded basements that didn't have to occur. With the next box over, we look at your sump pump. And a sump pump is really, in the basement of a house, you have a little well that looks like a bucket in the basement with a pump in the bottom of it. And that pump is there that if water enters the basement, you pump the water safely outside. What you want to do is check that sump pump to make sure it works, rather than finding out that it's been seized up and it doesn't run when you have 3 feet of water in the basement. What you can do is very easily dump a bucket of water into that sump well, see the pump turn on, pump water outside, and if that happens, you're good to go. And if it doesn't happen, you want to fix it before the storm. The third box over, window wells coverings, plastic covers over window wells. For windows around the base of your house at grade level, you want to make sure that you put a plastic cover over those window wells such that when the big storms hit, the water doesn't fill the window well and subsequently flow into the basement. And then finally on the lower right, we're back to our friend the sump pump, install a backup battery supply. In other words, the time you need the sump pump is when the big storms hit. But very often when the big storms hit, the electricity goes out. So the sump pump doesn't do you much good if there's no electricity supply, unless you've put a backup battery supply there to run the pump for a period of a couple of days. All of these items, and there's a longer list, can be implemented around the average house in, generally speaking, over a period of 1 or 2 days for less than a few hundred dollars with very little expertise required. So that's one example of how we've developed a program in Canada to mitigate basement flood risk. And using procedures that are almost not much more complex than this, we can also mitigate flood risk at the level of new community design and for existing communities so that we're not all running out at the last minute and putting hundreds of thousands of sandbags into place to hold water back when a big storm occurs. Now, the question is Canada preparing properly for climate change? Are we actually deploying the measures I've just talked about? The reality is, the good news is, we know what to do. We've developed the programs. Now we need to deploy them, and we need to deploy them rapidly. And I kind of liken it to this. If you're in a small compact car heading down the road in a particular direction with a certain destiny in mind, that's great. But if you look in your rearview mirror and you see a large tractor trailer coming up behind you at twice your speed, you're in trouble. You've got to speed up. And right now, the tractor trailer is climate change. It's catching up to us and causing damage much more quickly than the degree to which we're implementing programs to mitigate the risk. So the message for Canada is we have to move much, much more quickly to operationalize practices to mitigate flood risk. And the number one choice for Canada should be home flood protection. That is the single action we can engage in the country today that will do the most good for the greatest number of people for the least cost to get risk out of the system. Thank you very much.